Sorry about that. We were having a small technical issue. Thank you, Alex, for letting us know about that. So, you said the grape varietal or the seed varietal is from where again?
So, Petit Syrah originally comes from the Rhone Valley. So, that's in France.
Okay.
But, and this pairing does work so well. But Petit Syrah is one of those grapes that it really found in California, okay, which is pretty cool because there's not a lot of grapes that like are really kind of California indigenous. One, even though Zinfandel comes from Croatia originally, uh-huh, like people think California, think Zin, right?
Okay.
And Petit Syrah is another one of those grapes,
yeah,
where it's very widely cultivated here, and the expressions of Petit Syrah are the best in California, at least in my opinion. I think, okay, they're the best in, okay, the world.
Yeah.
Compared to like Cab, where like, I don't know, I love Bordeaux. I love stuff from Europe, but Petit Syrah, the best stuff you'll find is from here.
Okay.
Which,
okay,
is great.
And mm-hmm, I think that is a part of what wine intrigues me and that I can wrap my head around is like seed varietal versus like different categories they put in. Mm-hmm. Cause tobacco is very much a similar way. You have seed varietals that come from Cuba, that come from Nicaragua, mm-hmm, certain like that. And when people think like this cigar here, darker in color, they think Maduro. What's, sure, really happening, yeah, in the wine world too is, oh, this is a red wine. That's a white wine. Maduro is not the seed. Mm-hmm. Maduro is the shade of this cigar itself.
For sure. And I like how there's a lot of parallels, kind of what you just said in with, hold on, let me. Mm. This is wonderful, by the way. I'm so happy I finally got to get one of these sticks. Yeah, there's a lot of parallels with wine and tobacco in that it's not just about like the grape varietal or the seed. It's also about where was it grown?
Yeah.
Like what year did the grower have? Was it hot? Was it cold? Like how long did they dry it? In our case, how long did they macerate it or how long did they,
right,
ferment it? And so I think it's funny. I'll have people come into the winery all the time and they'll say stuff like red wine gives me headaches. And I'm like, well, let's unpack that for a minute. Right.
Yeah.
It might like that red wine, you know, we're talking, it could be the yeast, it could be tannins, it could be the sulfites. It could be another 4 to 5 different factors that might actually be giving you those headaches. Maybe they didn't ferment the sugar out fully. Right. It's just, mm-hmm, one of those. Once you know how much you don't know, right, the wine industry becomes like, it becomes a little bit, the wine world becomes a little bit bigger. But yeah, like that being said, it gets really exciting.
Yeah.
Kinda like, definitely, you know, like when you hit a certain point with cigars, right? And you started to understand like, whoa, this is way bigger than I thought it was. Like, yeah, how did that feel?
Yeah. Oh,
probably
no.
Felt it, really cool.
I feel, yeah, the education to the consumer, whether wine drinker, cigar smoker, mm-hmm, is really what we want to push at our shop, because the education means you can enjoy it more and you know what you're enjoying. So something I want to do, mm-hmm, before we delve into the story of Devon and wine, oh, and how that goes.
It's a funny one.
What I want to do is first, if you could indulge me, I would like to show you kind of some techniques that we do when we're tasting a cigar. How do we taste the cigar?
Let's go.
And then from there, if you can take me through tasting wine.
Yeah,
let's do it. I don't know. So for certain techniques is for us that we've learned is more of, you can look up cigars in the manufacturer. Hey, you're supposed to get these notes, these notes, these notes. I prefer make your mind blank. Try to clear your mind.
Yep.
When you try to, when you take your first draw, do you retrohale at all?
Retrohale?
Retrohale.
I don't know what that is.
Is when you bring a small percentage out through your nose. Hmm. Not all of it, because it'll be overwhelming. So last 10%. Mm-hmm. And you'll have that kind of, because you have more receptors on your nose. So you're going to taste some of that coming through your nose.
Okay.
So
that's kind of cool. Yeah.
So when I taste something like the Night Owl, we'll go ahead and take a puff together and see what our impressions are. So what kind of comes to your mind when you try it?
Let's see. I get a little graham crackery.
Okay.
Graham cracker texture. Okay. Slight like chocolate notes. I mean, you get like the and like deep earth textures, obviously. Mm-hmm. It's always been hard for me to like split apart the notes in a cigar as opposed to wine, right? And we always talk about how we have the opposite problem. I can get like 5 to 10 different notes out of a bottle of wine, and then with a cigar, maybe getting 2 or 3. But I think the more that I actually enjoy a stick, like mm-hmm. like the more sharper my palate will get.
Right, right, yeah. So. No, I definitely that earth, that cocoa. I almost get a little bit, maybe.
I get that too.
And that sweetness of graham cracker, I get that. And there's almost to me like a I could be wrong, but almost like a stone fruity type sweetness to it as well. Hmm. That's just like a deeper flavor. But I can definitely see that cocoa and that earth. And when we say full bodied, people mix it up sometimes with full strength. I feel like the smoke output at just the feel, the textural feel of the smoke is pretty full.
Sure.
And then the strength level is more in that medium plus. It's not like we're keeling over. It's too strong.
Oh no. Like this is really approachable for me. I don't know. Nice. It's also really difficult for me to kind of judge like strength in a cigar, right? Because this seems pretty easy, right? Yeah. And this is like medium to like full. Yeah, right?
Exactly. Hmm. So that is just a few notes that we pick up. And the thing that's interesting too is as you continue, you have your first third, second third, last third, those will change and alter depending on the blend.
Right. And so that's actually a really good segue because with wine, the more the wine oxidizes, the more oxygen gets introduced into this glass, the more that this is going to change, right?
Perfect.
So similarly, when you decide that you want to really just dive into a wine and examine it, you want to have your mind blank slate, just like Eric said. Okay. Same type of thing you're going to do with a cigar.
Okay.
First thing you're going to want to do is just smell it. Swirl it around, give it a little oxygen.
Okay, so the swirling of the glass is not some pretentious gimmick. Got a purpose.
It is not. Okay, and you know what? Yeah.
Because you go to certain weddings and you don't want to be like, excellent vintage. But you're like, what are you doing? I don't know.
You're like, I don't know. Someone told me to do it once, yeah, right?
Exactly.
And so when you swirl wine, you're actually introducing oxygen to it. And when you introduce oxygen to wine, you release the aromatics.
Okay.
So the more that you swirl, especially when a wine bottle is just opened up, more aromatics that you're going to get. So something on this is just like the Petite Syrah has a lot of deep berry notes on it. And it has some earth tones, like almost picture like a damp forest or something like that.
Okay.
Berry, damp forest, maybe you might actually get some espresso or tobacco notes on the nose, but really on the palate for this wine is where the magic happens.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, no, I definitely got very sweetness up front.
So this is actually a wonderful pairing. I've already been indulging a little bit. Oh, yeah. Right? The two really complement each other because just like this stick right here, that wine has a lot of espresso notes, blackberry jam notes. It has cacao. It's got the chocolate notes on it as well. And it just has a deeper, fuller texture. So when you take a nice drag of this cigar and then you actually put the wine on your palate and you let it coat, both of those flavors come together and it's a real symphony because this is like I picked a wine to bring up that I was like, I know that this pairs with cigars. When we do wine and cigar night together, this is always one of the ones that I recommend.
And so what is it about, like, how as one who enjoys wine, how is it that you know this is one that's probably going to pair pretty well?
So it's a good question.
Do you go through like complement, contrast, or anything like that? Or
what's nice is that Craig Suveg, who makes all of our wine, he's a sommelier.
Mm.
And so I've trained with Craig now for years, right? And anytime a wine club member hits us up, whether it be in person or through email, and asks, like, what should I pair with this?
Yeah.
Typically, we're going to have an answer. We want to make sure that when the wine is enjoyed off premise, people are still getting like a great experience.
Right.
So in this case, when Craig and I are tasting the wine together, we can tell really quickly what wines are going to pair well with a cigar.
Okay.
And so those wines are typically ones that are very earthy in texture. A lot of the time too, this dark extraction is going to make a difference.
Okay.
So there are only a couple reds that I wouldn't pair with a cigar. And those are the reds that are more delicate. They're lighter. They are going to, a cigar is going to overpower them. And so stuff like Pinot Noir, Beaujolais. Mm. Also, I think it goes without saying, don't pair a wine with a cigar. It's just really, like, there's not enough earth tones, texture, hold the cigar. So
yeah. Hmm. And it seems like on those you might get more like acidic type flavor notes that are happening.
Totally. And the best part about pairing red wine with a cigar as opposed to just like pairing whites, all white wine is based off of acidity. All white wine is based off of acidity, right? So that is going to be that puckery sensation that you get while you're drinking it. Because with white wine, you don't have any skin tannin that you're using to actually flavor the wine or create any of the color.
Okay.
So with with red wines, you can have that high acidity and a lot of boisterousness and that tart flavor. But if you have enough body as well, if you have enough tannin, and that's going to be the dryness on wine, mm-hmm. those are things that balance the wine out. And so a winemaker okay. is typically working with at least three different factors, main factors, tannin, acidity, extraction, and body, right? So
okay.
we'll call the last one factor. And anytime you have a lot of body and extraction like this, you can almost rest assured say that the wine's going to probably pair well with a cigar.
Okay.
And that's because this will coat your tongue. It's mm-hmm. going to feel thicker. So yeah. that feeling of thickness on the palate is really going to pair nicely when you also have smoke that envelops your tongue as well.
Right.
And so the wines that are red that I kind of would stray away from, those are the wines like Pinot Noir, Beaujolais, as I mentioned. And that's just because you have that the high acidity, mm-hmm. but you don't typically have a lot of body and you don't typically have a okay. lot of tannin. So stuff like this, our Petit Syrah. Let me take a pause and a
yeah,
drag.
Yeah, no worry.
Oh, yeah, it's getting better too. Especially when you do that little nose exhale
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
That's a technique. So I'm learning too.
There you go.
So with wines like Cabernet Sauvignon, Petit Syrah, Merlot, these are wines that are lower in acidity, higher in tannin, and higher in body, typically.
Okay.
These are all wines that are going to pair wonderfully with a stick. And that's because with that tannin, that dryness, the smoke is actually going to take the tannin profile on the wine down. So it's going to make your tongue feel less dry somehow. And it's really interesting.
Yeah.
So like when you have a high tannin wine and you pair it with a cigar, all of a sudden that dryness on your mouth doesn't, it kind of goes away. It fades into the background a little bit. Which
interesting.
Is really cool.
Yeah, no, definitely. Mm. Definitely. So kind of as we alluded to earlier, what started you on this path of getting into wine? I mean, cigars, similar thing is, I mean, it's not just something you say, one day I'm going to be working in wine.
One day I'm going to open a cigar palace.
Right. So what was the evolution like?
So it's a true story. My parents have, good on them, they've done very well for themselves. They have about a 500 bottle collection of wine, and they have a 600 bottle wine cellar. And so what I would do.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to run out of space.
Well, they also have this, as a quick aside, they fall victim to this mentality where they keep buying wine to age, but they're like approaching their 70s. And I have to tell them, like, what the hell are you doing? Like, your wine's going to outlive you. Like, you need to start drinking all your wine. And they're the people who've like kind of started to look at wine more as like an object of culture than something to just consume, mm-hmm. which I'm down for someone to look at it like an object of culture, but at the end of the day, it's something for you to drink and enjoy.
Right,
so like,
right.
like why I don't want their wine collection. I want them to drink every bottle. But I was like 13 or 14. I think we're like the same age too, somewhere
yeah.
around there.
Yeah.
And that's when Google became a thing, right?
Yeah.
So what I would do is when they were gone, I would walk into their cellar. I would take out bottles of wine and I would type them into Google. The reason I was doing that is so I could figure out if I could take them and drink them without them noticing. And when you Google 400 or 500 bottles of wine over the course of, I don't know, 3 or 4 years, you start to see commonalities. You start to see like, oh, this says Bordeaux and it's from 1982, 86, like 89, 90, like don't drink those. Those are going to be really expensive bottles of wine. Or like, oh, it says Barolo from Italy or Barbaresco or anything from the Rhone Valley. I'm like,
could you even pronounce all these words at that
time? Oh yeah, I could. Cause I would ask the parents to, again, type it into Google and be like, well, tell me what this sounds like. I'd ultimately find bottles of like, I don't know, like $8 or $9 like Bogle Old Vine Zin or something that they would buy by the case and it would just be daily drinking wine. They would throw it on a table and they would always be there. So those are the bottles that I would take. And sure enough, I don't know, 50, 60 bottles later, they never noticed anything that went missing because it was all just like the cheap wine. But in the process, I got a wine education and it opened the door. It opened up the world of questions that I have, like, why a bottle of wine from 1982 in this specific region be four times the cost of
right.
the same bottle produced in 1990 mm-hmm. or 1991, right? Why is that?
Yeah.
Or like, you know, the same year, we'll say, like, I'd create these bold assumptions when I was younger and I didn't know anything about wine. It's like, oh, you know, 1999 must have been a great year, right? But then you look and you're like, oh, this 1999 from this region is priced to sell at pennies. Why is that?
Okay, right? Yeah.
So you start seeing that, like, oh, each region has so and again, the world can be the whole wine industry gets more and more complex the more you dive into it. But each region, the price of the wine heavily depends upon vintage. So mm-hmm. did the grapes hit their peak maturity that year? Were the grapes processed into a wine that can last a very long time and age gracefully? And so, like, these are all the things that I kind of found out over time, and I just kept diving even deeper. And I worked in craft beer for a while in New York, because I lived in New York City before I moved back to help Craig build Suveg Cellars. But ultimately, wine has kind of been where it's at
okay.
for me, always.
Okay.
So
what did that? I'm just out of curiosity, because, like, okay, so you're researching this on Google, and you're learning about wine under the radar.
Oh yeah.
So did one day did you just tell your dad, hey, this is a so such and such, and I've been enjoying it. Like, how did that come about? How did they be like, you know all this about wine? Where'd it come from?
Fortunately, my parents were quite oblivious to the fact that I was taking their wine. And also, it was probably when I moved back to California, and I could just talk the lingo, and I had been doing all the research. I had to read the wine Bible. Before I started working with Craig, he hands me a copy of the wine Bible. It's like this anthology of every wine region in the world. And he just says, read the whole damn thing before you work with me. And I go, okay, man, I will. And what's nice is that
wow.
I knew a lot of the
wow.
info,
yeah.
but like he, I also learned a ton too. And so, yeah, it was divulged to my parents probably in the last 2 years that I stole 60 bottles of wine from them as a teenager. But they didn't even blink. They're like, oh, okay, whatever. Like, you didn't take any of the good wine, so thank you. Which
that's crazy.
Which is best case scenario for me.
Well, and so you had mentioned with Craig and being a sommelier, when did he start his winery of Suveg?
So Suveg Cellars started in 2010 officially.
Okay.
And that was Craig making very small batches. We're talking like a total case production for the year of 2010-11 of like 250 cases.
Okay.
And at this point, our case production is like a couple thousand cases a year. So it's
wow.
a big difference in terms
yeah.
of how much wine we're making, how
yeah.
much wine that's moving out the front door and coming in the back. But yeah, he had a... It's funny because he got his start like drinking Charles Shaw.
$2 chug?
Yeah, chug is where he kind of got his start. But then he found a lot of... You feel a lot of value in the experience of drinking wine, how it can change. You know, like when you open a bottle, it's going to be completely different in 3 hours, just like the cigar is changing as we smoke it. Awesome. So he got more and more into wine, and then he started making wine just as a hobby, right?
Okay.
You start to realize that it's a very expensive hobby very quick.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it seems like. And also, like, the investment of time. And I mean, it's not something you can just pump out. Like,
it's not. Also, you have, like once a year, you get to make wine in the Northern Hemisphere, right? Like, the grapes are going to come in from September through mid-October into November. And, like, that's it. Like, you have one shot every year to make good wine. And you know, you're any type of craft. And I'll take a quick tangent here, but it relates back to what I'm about to say. Any craft or any skill set that you're working on, right? The way to get better is iterative, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have as many iterations as possible, and the iterative process with wine is actually really slow. You get your grapes, you make them, and then once the wine is in a barrel, you can still alter the flavor of the wine, and you can do things to improve the quality of that wine while you're aging it. But most of the time, like, your wine is already set.
Okay.
Like, once you've made it, like, there's you can affect it 10 to 20% in either direction, I would say. And actually, 10%, let me take that back. You can make it maybe 20% better, and you could also ruin it and make it 100% worse. If you don't if you don't manage oxygen, if you don't properly sulfite, if you don't manage TA, so you didn't like ferment all the sugar out of it by accident. So he loved the process. He loves making wine. It's kind of his zen. And the more and more practice he got, the more he liked it. And he kept upping the ante every year and buying more grapes. And finally, he said around 2014, he's like, I need to just turn this into a commercial enterprise because I'm spending a lot of money myself doing it. And here we are, 7 years after that. You know, we got a bustling tasting room on California Street in Ucaipa. We got an awesome wine club, tons of supportive people, and his wine does keep getting better every year. Every year. And so, yeah, he's really been able to kind of find his sweet spot, the varietals he likes. And, and you know, most California wineries as well, they're making pretty traditional stuff, right? You'll see Cab, you'll see Syrah, you'll see the varietal of the grape, which is just the genus of Venus vinifera. So it's kind of like the seed type of tobacco. It's just one type of grape that you make that you grow that has different qualities to it.
Right.
And so, you know, once Craig started figuring out what he liked and developing his palate, we've really focused more on the Italians in the last couple of years. He loves Italian grapes. So stuff that I'm sure a lot of viewers haven't heard of, like Nera Diavola, Barbera, Dolcetto. Like his Dolcetto that he has on the menu right now is my favorite wine. And people are like, what the hell is a Dolcetto? And so I actually, like a big part of what I do, kind of like what you do, is just wine education. Like, what is this damn grape? Like, people come in and say, I'm a Cab guy. And I'm like, actually, you're just this type of guy. You're a person who likes high tannin, low acid wine. Right. There's a bunch of wines you're going to like. They're like, oh, really? And
As far as being on the outside of that, I mean, for me, I'm like, oh, yeah, I know red wine. There's Merlot, Cab, and there's Pinot Noir. Those are the red wines.
Yeah.
So it's like, yeah, it's fascinating and to see those differences and the, like, as you're saying, kind of like almost the not, what's the word I'm looking for? Mm-hmm. Not the most like popular or, common.
Or like, let's just say, varietals of grapes that are most widely known or acknowledged, or even available. And there's just in Italy, there's over 3,000 grape varietals.
It's crazy.
Crazy stuff, right? Yeah. And so we're making a wine this year, and we made it last year called Alianico. And we tell people that. They're like, what are you doing? Just make your Syrah. It's really good. And Craig's like, no, we like this stuff. And like, I do love, Craig and I kind of experienced Alianico for the first time together. And we're like, this is the kind of wine we want to make.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's looking at it as an opportunity to be kind of an emissary for these Italian grapes or for these grapes that aren't really getting the acknowledgement and the credit that they deserve. So every year we're making more and more eclectic stuff. Like we're making Tannat this year. And like, this year we're going to make Cab and we're going to make some Zin too because we haven't made it in a couple of years. But, you know, the more we brand out, the more fun we have too.
Yeah.
Can you imagine just like selling the same 10 cigars?
No.
Right?
No. And I mean, for us too, it's a similar on that kind of like, I always bring the analogy because it seems to be the one that's most understood is like the craft brewing of the industry. And it's, I mean, you know, you have your Budweiser's, your Miller Lights and all those, which I'm not knocking, but a lot of people,
they have their occasion.
Right. And a lot of people in America are moving more towards that craft side.
Sure.
And it's cigars and wine. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it's funny how you're saying with varietals too, one of the most common or more popular that's in our humidor is a seed called Corojo, which is originally a Cuban seed.
Yeah, tell me more about that. Corojo, like.
Yeah, and so originally it's known for its sweetness, a little bit of pepper, a little bit of earth, and it has that Cuban heritage behind it. But the issue is that it was very susceptible in Nicaragua and Dominican and Honduras for blue mold and black shank, which are diseases.
Okay.
So to fight that, they created a hybrid called Corojo 99, and now you see it on a lot more because it's so rich.
It's so interesting. And it also, it's funny to hear a lot of people rail against GMOs because like what you're describing, right? Like, yeah, sure. That's genetically modified by way of human intervention. Right.
Right.
And that's one way to alter the genetics of any plant. But like now with that slight variation and that modification, you're going to be like, you're able to now offer a product to the whole world that you couldn't offer before because the plant couldn't cope with, I don't know, the humidity. It didn't have the defense mechanisms.
Right. Yeah.
And so wine's the same way, man. You'll have people crossing different types of clones all the time. Craig's a little bit more of a traditionalist. I go out and I'll drink some crazy stuff from time to time. But that being said, like, that's really cool that they were able to cultivate it then.
Right, so. Right. So then you get hired by Craig at mm-hmm. Suveg. And what year was this again?
2018.
2018.
So, okay. Yeah, I moved back from Brooklyn, New York, beginning of 2018. And we worked together to open the tasting room May of 2018.
Wow.
Crazy stuff, wow. Man. It's been 3 years and 3 months, 4 months.
The last year has been a little interesting, to
last,
say the least.
Last year felt like 5 years.
Yeah.
In 1 year.
I for anyone watching, I would not advise opening a shop in 2020 if you ever had the chance. It's not the wisest thing to do.
Advisable. I also would not recommend running a winery in 2020 either. Yeah. It was not a lot of fun. But look at us. We made it through.
Yeah, surviving it. So when you started, were you just like at the front? Like, what was your role? And then how has it changed through the last years?
So I have a background in digital marketing and business development. Okay. I built up those. I wasn't really good at them for a long time. I worked on building up those skills in New York, working with friends on projects. Also just like figuring out how to deliver results. Like, at the end of the day, when someone would hire me to do something, sometimes I would take on a job that I knew I wasn't fully qualified for, but I also knew the broad strokes and how to get the job done.
Okay.
And I've joked with friends that I should just open an LLC called Pay Me to Google Shit. Like, because that's it. Like,
yeah,
it's all self-taught. Like, you probably, because this is StreamYard, right?
Yeah.
You probably typed into Google. You're like, hey, what best streaming platform, multi, with dual connections, like
right,
something
right.
like that, right?
Yep, yep.
And so, I kind of built up that repertoire of skills over the course of, 2017 up, actually 2016 through 2018 in that range. And Craig calls me. Says, I need someone who can run a tasting room and understands technology and knows digital marketing. And I was like, well, you're really limiting your options, Craig. There aren't a lot of people who can do that. And it's, sure enough, I was just kind of a lock to key fit for the place
when
we opened it up. And as the place has grown, I've taken on more responsibilities and evolved from tasting room manager to winery director, who now has a couple employees under his employ, and we're growing our team as of now. If you know anyone, please send them my way who knows wine and wants to work in a really great tasting room with a great community. The whole thing just kind of started moving up into the right from there. Obviously, everyone hit a snag last year, but we made it through. That was the important thing. So yeah, my role there has just evolved with the company as it's grown and more responsibilities have popped up for me. They've centered on things that just needed to be done. Mm. Like, oh, how do we deal with this problem? Cool. I'll just handle it.
Right. It's right. One of those things. Which is great. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Going straight at it. And has it afforded you, I mean, I know that you stay really busy at the winery. Mm-hmm. Has it afforded you the opportunities to go to like Napa or visit other areas?
You know, I don't use my industry credentials enough. It's something that I plan on doing. I said once California opens again, like, I'm going everywhere. Well, I haven't gone everywhere. I've gone to a couple places. I like going up to Paso, drinking with some people that we know in the industry who are really great, and I learn a lot from. I want to make my way up to Amador County, up north in the Sierra foothills. I'd love to go to Sonoma as well. Pretty much, I once I can kind of like hire more people, spend a little less time, because I mean, you get it, man. You're a one-man, you're a one-man crew.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so, once I can kind of get a team in place, now that we're hopefully, knock on, there's plenty of wood around here, barring any unforeseen shutdowns or anything like that.
Right.
I'm definitely going to be making more trips to those areas, because I just have a lot of questions now.
Right.
And another thing too, a lot of people don't know what's kind of happening in the Yucaipa Valley with wine.
I've heard that, and Craig and you have both been somewhat more of a like pushing pushing that as far as like grape development and growth.
Yeah. So Craig Suveg and I wrote the Yucaipa Valley AVA petition. So it's a federal petition that makes the Yucaipa Valley, which includes all of Oak Glen, all of Calamasa, parts of Cherry Valley, and all of Yucaipa, it makes it a federally designated and recognized wine region. There's only like 280 of them in the entire country, which is nuts. And yeah, we are going to be one of the highest, we're going to be the highest elevation AVA in California. We're going to have some of the most unique terroir. We have some of the highest temperature fluctuations. We got great soil because we're right up next to the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
And it creates this environment for growing grapes that's on par. And I'll just say it. It's on par with like Howell Mountain in Napa Valley.
Wow.
You can grow grapes in Yucaipa and Oak Glen, and you can take those grapes and make bottles of wine that sell for $200 to $300.
Wow.
And it's you have to have some freak geographic and meteorological confluences just to have that happen.
Okay.
And so we're in the process right now of pushing industry development here. We have, go figure, over 40 vineyards now, ranging from like 150 vines to like 5 acres.
Wow.
And more and more going in all the time. And so
that's great.
And so, could you imagine if this place turns into like Paso or Napa? Wouldn't be bad, right?
No. And so, and actually that brings a really good point as far as the soil and the climate. And, when people first start getting into cigars, whenever, let's say someone's dabbled in it and you ask them, oh, what cigars do you like to have? Mm-hmm. Or what was one of the best cigars you had? You know, at some point, the word Cuban is going to come up at some point. And
it will.
We won't get into all of the Cuban aspect of it. However, that is now known as like the original traditional world of tobacco. Mm-hmm. Now there's new world tobacco, which is Nicaragua, Puerto Rico, Dominican, and Honduras. And a lot was found is that Nicaragua creates this rich, more robust taste.
Okay.
And kind of just like more full bodied on strength, even like the lighter Connecticut's have like more of a punch to it because of the heavy volcanic soil that's on Nicaragua.
Very cool. Okay.
And so a large portion of that is soil. And it sounds like with wine, there's that similarity again of that the soil and the climate is what's really fueling that fire.
Exactly. And the grapes from the best regions in the world, pretty much you take them, you pick them, and if you don't treat them like shit, you're going to have an incredible product. Like it's yours to mess up, right?
Okay.
Like a good vintage in Bordeaux, for example, like 2016 on Left Bank was insane, and it was perfect weather. Like you need to have rains within like a 2-week period to like rehydrate the vines, get hydric reserves, and like provide that final stretch through harvest. Then they got those rains.
And that's what produces that vintage?
That's what produces the vintage. So with wine, every bottle of wine in America and most bottles of wine in Europe are going to have a year on them. That's just the year that the grapes were cultivated. And so you can't escape vintage. And that's what they say. We have like a lot of serious collectors who actually come to the winery, and every one of them says the same thing. You can't escape vintage. So no matter how good the climate may be, the soils, right? Like if you have torrential rains during harvest, cool, you might as well just throw all your wine out. Because what'll happen is all those grapes will just absorb all the water. And when they absorb all the water, your wine gets super diluted and it turns very watery.
Okay.
So well-timed rains make a perfect vintage. Poorly timed rains can ruin your crop for the whole year. So there's a lot of risk involved.
Well, yeah, definitely.
And I actually had a question for you because you brought up Cubans, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So in your estimation, like short answer, right? Why are people so obsessed with them? Because I've found that like I've had very pleasurable cigars from Nicaragua, right? From all over the place.
Uh-huh.
And I know too that you can take the seeds and plant them in different places and you can get a different expression of the same seeds that are being grown in Cuba. So what is it that people love about a Cuban cigar?
I think two elements that really put into it. And one is the families and the history and the knowledge that these families have in the craft of making cigars.
So pedigree.
Yeah, that's a large portion. I mean, some of the oldest names, which is Monte Cristo and Partagas and all these people making these cigars. But what people don't understand is later on when Castro there, and then they all refugeed out of Florida, a lot of those families left, and now they're producing the cigars in New World tobacco. That knowledge went with them. That craftsmanship went with them.
Super interesting. Wow.
And two is that if Cubans were readily available in America, I don't think we would see the same demand. It's that mystique. It's that, gotcha. I have a Cuban. And there's certain other brands that I won't really mention, but they're decent, but you know, it's the $150 cigar.
Sure.
So it's, hey, what's one of the best cigars you had? Well, I had this. It was $150. It has to be good. And
oh my God, we should talk about diminishing returns in a minute, because this is such a great topic of convo.
Unfortunately, and I just was listening to a podcast the other day, and there's a lot of New World cigars from Dominican Nicaraguan that can't get into Europe. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people in Europe are saying, hey, no, a lot of the greater stuff are coming out from here, and we can't get them, and we want them. Whereas, you know, you can go to England, you can pick up your Cohiba, you can pick up your Partagas D4. But the issue about it is, and you probably know this as well, is whenever you're farming something like grapes or tobacco, you have to turn that soil.
You do.
And you have to let it, you have to let the tobacco speak to you, let the grape speak to you. Cuba does not have that luxury, unfortunately, where they can pick a harvest in early April and have it ready to smoke by December. Most cigars need a resting period in aging, so they're not having time to turn over.
Gotcha.
Sorry, that was not a short answer.
No. That was really, again, super informative. We're all here to learn. So, but no, I love how you brought up price, right? I'm like, let's talk about price, because in the wine world, we'll have a bunch of people. By a bunch, I mean a select few special people who come in and try and name drop wines that they drink. Right? Uh-huh, they'll say stuff.
But it's, see, industries that carry over commonalities,
right? So people will be like, you ever had Opus One? You ever had Kistler? You ever had, I don't know, like Diamond Creek Continuum? And like, mind you, these are all names of very high end Napa Valley cab. And some of them I have had. And I never understood the need for someone to like tell me what they drink.
Right.
And I'm sure this happens to you all the time. Right. It's like, oh, that's so cool. You brought this, woke up this morning waiting for you to come and tell me what you drink. You're probably like, oh yeah, I woke up today so excited for you to tell me what you smoke.
The example I've always used, you've met this person as well, is they'll come into the humidor and they'll cross their arms and sit back almost as if they're like sitting in a chair while telling you this.
Oh my God. And I know, right?
It's that same name dropping, and it's a good thing that they've tried these things, but at the same time, no one's going to try this on a normal basis. And if you are, you're probably not going to be in my shop.
Right. And also I think that what they don't know is that it really doesn't signify quality all the time. And like, just because you paid a lot for something, that might not actually be the best wine in the world.
Right.
And just because you paid $200 for, you know, or like $500 for a pre-embargo Monte Cristo, like that might not be the best cigar in the world. Mm-hmm. And so diminishing returns are very real in the wine world. And so here's how I tell, and wine buying 101, this is what I tell people in the tasting room when they ask me about, like, I'm in a store, I don't know what the hell's going on, and like, I don't know what I'm doing because there's so many different selections. So the first thing I say is that, and this is really unfortunate, but wine marketers are out there to confuse you. They don't actually want you to understand vintage, varietal, terroir.
Which is so unfortunate.
It's so unfortunate. Yeah, you go, they want you to pick a label based upon how cool it looks. And I've sat in on marketing conversations in our industry. I'm like, this is crazy. You're not trying to give people the ability to make informed decisions at all. You want them to make a decision based upon a label, a wrapper, wrapper of a cigar or something right? And so when I say wine buying 101, I tell people there are certain areas where price and quality are correlated.
Okay.
Under $25 or under $20, I should say, you're going to get a wine that's probably not of the highest quality. Because once you're able to sell wine for under $20, that means that the people who make it have hit a certain production point and they are doing things so mechanically. The artisanship is very much removed from the process, and it's very hard to sell a wine for under $20 that has any artisanal value to it. It's hard. It happens sometimes. And there's what I'm about to say, there's outliers in each of these cases.
Right, right.
So this is, there's exceptions that, will break these rules all the time. From $25 to $60, there is no correlation between price and quality on a bottle of wine.
Really?
I have yet to find it.
Wow.
It's and that's crazy to say, right? Yeah. I've had bottles of $25 wine that taste like $70 bottle wine. I've had bottles of $50 to $60 bottle wine that I wouldn't even drink. And so that area between $25 and $60, maybe even we'll call it $70,
mm-hmm.
there's almost no correlation, and there's a very loose correlation between price and quality.
Okay.
Then you hit like $70 to like $150, that correlation starts coming back. If you spend $70 to $150 on a bottle of wine, you will very likely get a pleasurable experience. Like that's where the correlation starts centering, right?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Now whether or not it's astounding, mind-blowing, or just like a damn good bottle or something you would drink again, between $70 and $150, you will get correlation. After $150 and above, again, no correlation. Like you can...
Wow.
I've had bottles of wine that are... you know, far more than $150, where I'm like, cool. I've had bottles of $40, $50 wine that could compete with this easily. And a lot of it might have to do with pedigree, right? It might have to do with the fact that this family has made this wine for 400 years in this location.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's like, all right, that's cool, but that doesn't mean that it tastes good.
So in your opinion, then what is it that separates, like what makes a wine more expensive than the other? On the common sense, is it just that marketing and the pedigree, or there are like vintages that go into it, or?
So the way that wine is priced, and I don't want to get too far into the weeds for the viewers here, because this can get super complicated. I'll try and spark note it.
Okay.
The way that wine is priced in Europe is completely different than the way that wine is priced in America.
Okay.
So in America, there's almost no dependence on vintage. Also, the aging standards are very different too. So in California, which is one of the largest producers of wine in the world, most producers, they need to take wine, if it's a red wine and they want to barrel age it, you're looking at 12 to 18 months, and that's very common. After that period, and you keep the wine on a rotating basis, right? You are going to take the wine out and you're going to sell it for, say, $45 a bottle. And no matter what vintage, you're going to be selling for $45 a bottle, right?
Okay.
So there's a couple reasons that we do that. One, unlike all these European estates that have been in families for hundreds of years and there's virtually no overhead, wine in the United States is a business, first and foremost. There's a lot of overhead. There's a big risk of like really losing your ass if you don't run a winery properly. And so price doesn't fluctuate that much. You need to get what you need to get for a bottle of wine because your costs are fixed. Now in Europe, especially with some of these older, by the way, I'm gonna pour you some more wine. So especially with some of these older estates, the places with that pedigree, if they have all their overhead paid off and they had their overhead paid off with the exception of barrel inventory for the last 300 years, right? If they have an exceptional vintage, that demand driven by publications like Wine Spectator, Wine Enthusiast, Decanter, they can charge 20, 30, 40% more for that vintage because the word's gotten out that, like, I'll give you just some examples. 2015 in the Northern Rhone Valley was one of the best vintages in 100 years. Perfect growing season. Producing wines that you can buy now and drink in 50 years. Because the serious collectors out there want a piece of that, everyone can take their prices up, and they know they can.
So, okay, so that's interesting. And and is there what is it? Does tax pay anything? Is there a tax on wine? Is there a tax on like statewide, federal?
So, there's an excise tax on every bottle of wine. Every bottle of wine you buy, we actually pay a tax on. So you don't see that tax, but we pay it. It's something we have to do. When it comes to buying European wine in the United States, or let's just say foreign wine, Australian wine, Argentinian Malbec, you need an importer's license just to get it into the States. Those importer licenses are very expensive. And if you're able to finagle one, again, you have to be backed by a lot of money in order to really run this business properly. I think an importer's license is about $125,000. Yes. just to get wine from Europe to the United States. It's pretty nuts, man.
I mean, in a similar way, I bring that up because, I mean, in California and on tobacco, that is one of the biggest giants that we is excess.
Sure.
The cigar you're smoking right now has 63.49% tax on that cigar.
That's unreal.
Insane. So
that's insane.
That plays a big role in price fluctuation in our market. But also similar things too, collector items. And it's interesting because it even follows a parallel. I mean, I'm more of a whiskey drinker.
For sure.
And so recently we walked into Total Wine, picked up this bourbon. Haven't seen it on the shelf forever.
Mm-hmm.
And this company rescues old barrels that have been aging forever.
Okay.
Bottle it, and then they're done.
Okay, cool. That's really rare.
And so this bottle is like $130. And I'm like, well, I know it's going to go up in price. And this is a week ago. Now that price is worth $300. Mm-hmm. And just
wow.
Insane of how those things happen, how you're saying vintages and collector's items and taxes, all these things in play to really find that like good priced commodity, whether mm-hmm. it's cigar or wine. It's just it's a struggle a lot of the time.
Well, yeah, especially when I had no idea the tax structure beyond tobacco.
That's crazy.
That's crazy to me. I know that like states like California and New York like tax the hell out of all tobacco products,
but like
a 63% tax. That's not. It's like a gallon of gas.
And what's insane too is that California didn't even get the worst of it. New York went from 28% to 75%.
75%
during the shenanigans of last year, certain politicians, lead politicians in that state, decided, hey, there's no hearings, that we're going to push it through.
And all right, no in person stuff.
Yeah.
Oh man, they are good. They are good at that.
Yeah,
they're very good at
that. So as we kind of come to the end here, there's several questions that I ask the manufacturers that we interview, and I'm going to try to draw that parallel with wine.
Mm-hmm.
So, for instance, let's say I'm a consumer. And I don't really have the opportunity to go to wineries or to like Total Wine and such. If I were to walk into Stater Brothers, what would be your recommendation? You're like, you know what? I've had this wine and this is something I would drink. This is something I could recommend.
Okay. So if you were to walk into Stater Brothers to buy wine, my actual recommendation is walk out. Just because you're... you're going to be putting yourself in a situation where you're trying to make a decision without any knowledge, right?
Right.
And that's and so if you think about it, right? Say you don't know anything about electronics, right? But you want a big you want a new television.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you go to Best Buy and instead of having someone there to answer your questions, there's no help. Right? That's not going to be a good buying experience for you. It's probably going to leave a sour taste in your mouth. And the last thing that I want, because there are so many people in my industry who leave a bad taste in your mouth surrounding wine. Either they're too pretentious, either they're not really in it for the education. They're just in it to sell the bottle of wine and move people along like it's a cattle car.
Mm-hmm.
My recommendation, first off, if you want to learn about wine, there's some really great resources out there.
Okay.
So like go to winefolly.com. Like, that's one of the most popular blogs on the internet, and you can learn so much about wine, where it comes from, what type of wine. If you like Pinot Noir, they have articles like 10 wines you'll like if you like Pinot Noir, right?
Okay, yeah.
And so before you go buy anything, definitely do your best to like do a little research on your own, just so when you go in, you're not stressed out. You're not like, you know, going, I think about going to buy wine. If I didn't know any better, it would be like going to buy toothpaste, right? So like picture going to a store right now. There's 70 toothpaste options. They're completely undifferentiated. And you're like, I don't know. Just give me that one.
Right.
And you're like, why are there so many? Like, what's the point of me trying to make an informed decision where I'm not a dentist. I don't know anything about like oral care to that degree.
Right.
But to me, it's a tube of toothpaste. Just give me that one. Right.
Yeah.
So I think another thing too is, Don't get discouraged by the way that our industry works, because if you come into a place like Suveg Cellars, like myself or Amber, we'll tell you everything that we know about wine free of charge. Like, you don't have to buy anything from us. You can just come in and be like, you know, I haven't really liked wine that much. I kind of like this one and this one. I'll just go into it, because ultimately our goals are probably the same. Like, we want you to enjoy what we have. We want you to enjoy the industry. Like, if you don't enjoy tobacco and you come in to visit the Oakland tobacconist, you're probably not going to have a good experience.
Right.
Right. But same thing's true with us. If you don't enjoy wine and you come in and you already have a bad taste in your mouth, you know, it's hard for me to really overcome that and offer a positive experience.
Right. So, and I think really that's what sets Suveg so aside, is aside from the production of really good wines and, as you kind of said, eclectic taste, and it's something that's really special. The beating heart of it is you and Craig and Amber, and it's that personal relationship of almost trust. Mm-hmm. The more that you try that, that really makes the experience enhanced.
Well, I appreciate
better.
That, man. And what I want to tell everyone too is I have a lot of people come in and say, I'm a beer drinker, I'm a whiskey drinker, right? And they'll be sitting there with a glass of wine and I'll be like, well, it looks like you're a wine drinker too. Right. There is, and whatever anyone has told you, there is a wine out there that you'll probably enjoy. And it doesn't need to be a, you know, $250 bottle of Bordeaux. Mm-hmm. It doesn't need to be a Napa cab. It could, who knew? Like there are a couple people that have really developed their palates with us, and like, they've found out that they love Italian wines. They like high acidity wines, right? And they didn't even know what acidity in wine was. But
right.
I've said, oh, you're going to Paso? Go to these five places. You're gonna expand your palate there.
Yeah.
And now they've gone down the rabbit hole, and they're doing it for themselves. And so, like, yeah, I would tell everyone out there, don't get discouraged by how like ridiculous our market is, and the fact that there are some really poor incentives at play. Just know that if you put yourself in the right environment with the right people, you'll find some stuff you really enjoy. And it could open up a whole new world for you.
Okay. Okay.
And also, yeah, another quick thought, we were talking about price. And like one of my concluding thoughts on that too is that like whether or not it's a cigar, whether or not it's wine, if you love it and you're really into it, get as price insensitive as you can. So like, let's say, right, that you are like, say that Eric loves blue jeans, right? And like, that becomes one of his favorite things in the world. I think it's insane if he doesn't go out there and spend $250 on a dope pair of jeans, because it makes him super happy, right? So most of the wine adventures that I have, and I will go out and I have purchased bottles of wine for $300-$500, right? But I also am, I don't spend a lot of money on clothes because I don't value that experience. I don't spend a lot of money on like a luxury car because that's not my thing. It just needs to get me to where I'm going. Right. And so for me to over index and spend on the things I care about, makes me a happier person. And whether or not that's wine or a cigar, I think just good advice to take away from this convo is find something you want to over index on and just go all in on it.
Right.
It's going to make your life way better.
Yeah. And you have more of those experiences to pull from.
Oh yeah.
Now, another question I would have is, because normally we ask the question of how many cigars do you smoke a day? So I would say, how many glasses of wine do you think that you normally are tasting a day?
I should probably plead the fifth on this.
I assume that also really plays a role in what you're tasting, if you're at the tasting room, if you're trying new stuff out, quality control, etc.
Oh, yeah. I've done a lot of stuff in the names of QC that I shouldn't have done. That's for sure. When I started working with Craig, when you have unlimited access to damn good wine, you tend to drink a lot of it. So there were periods from 2018 into like probably the beginning of 2020 where like, yeah, I'd probably be like a minimum of two glasses anytime I work because I like drinking with our clientele too.
Right,
it's super enjoyable. But I've cut it back a little bit. And not to mention, once I've had our wine so many times, it's like, cool, I know what it tastes like.
Yeah.
I'll drink a glass of wine to share an experience with you and have that moment. But that being said, I'm not going to drink it anymore.
Right, right.
I'm just going to drink because I value the person that I'm with. And like, obviously I value the product or I would never be a part of the organization.
Right.
But I've scaled back a little bit on drinking for drinking's sake.
Yeah. No, totally, totally. So, and if you have a like, do you have a optimum level experience, or I should say environment in which you enjoy wine? Like normally it's like, you know, whether it's music or mm-hmm. whether it's being with certain people or being at a certain place, do you have like an experience that's like optimal?
So I'm going to quote Wes Hagen on this. And Wes Hagen is a legend in the wine world. I've had the pleasure of grabbing lunch with him a couple times, and Craig's had the pleasure of making wine with him. Wes Hagen was quoted saying, I'd rather drink Bud Light with my boys than Romani Conti with my enemies. And Romani Conti is the most expensive wine in the world. Supposedly amazing, I haven't had it. Yet. I will one day, I'm sure. But I'm with him. And that the optimal experience is sharing wine with people that you care about in an environment that you're comfortable with. And you know what? Like, there have been times where, you know, the wine's flowing and it's me and some close friends I haven't seen in a while. It could have been Charles Shaw and I wouldn't have been disappointed.
Yeah.
It's
definitely.
Like, environment plays a major role in how you perceive flavor, right?
Right.
And yeah, the best place for you to drink wine is with the people you care about.
Okay. Yeah. And then final question is, mm-hmm. I mean, oftentimes when we're talking to people, we'll talk to cigar reps, they travel the country, mm-hmm. they go to cigar shops all around the world. And so the question I would have is, what is one of your most unique, good or bad, strange experiences you've had while having like a glass of wine, or whether it's at the tasting room or something like that?
So I've had a strange one where it really put the wine world into perspective for me. I guess I could tell that, and I won't name the winery that I had it at. I went to one of the most famous and highly lauded wineries in Paso Robles. I'm not going to say which one it was, but it was just Craig and I. And sometimes we'll go in and we won't tell people we're industry, because we just want to see how we're treated. We want to like also see what their tasting room experience is like.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
And then later on, like, we might be like, oh yeah, like, he makes wine and I run his winery. Like, could we hang out, speak to your winery director, your winemaker, like, all depending upon how things are. So in this case, Craig and I are drinking a bottle, or we're drinking a tasting of, let me grab that.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. We have a tasting in our glass of a Cabernet Sauvignon that retails at $175, right? And both him and I are looking at each other, and Craig says to me, do you smell and taste VA on this wine? And I said, yeah, I do.
No, wait, sorry. So, this is going to sound incredibly ignorant.
Don't worry. I'm about to explain it.
Okay.
So VA is volatile acidity. So when you don't ferment all the sugar out of your wine and you have poor oxygen management, you get this chemical called ethyl acetate that winds up in your wine. And if you can smell it and taste it, it's a really bad thing. It means it's actually above the legal parts per million a winery can sell a wine at. So there was sense perception for both of us. Like, just so everyone knows, it smells like nail polish remover.
Okay.
Right? And okay. So Craig and I are both like, yeah, there's definitely VA on this wine. And we were kind of like, do we say anything? It's crazy. Cause this is a famous winery. And, so guy comes over, and at this winery, all the people behind the counter are sommeliers. They all have a somm license and degree. And so we hadn't really given them any hints that we were industry. And it was a dead giveaway when Craig looks at the somm and goes, hey man, just to ask, like, is there a VA on this wine? And the guy changes his tone and tenor immediately. He's like, oh, so you guys are industry. And we're like, yeah, we're industry. But more importantly, like, do you get VA on this wine? And he says to us without skipping a beat, oh yeah, man, there's VA on this wine. There's VA on a lot of our wine, but it's no big deal. And just walks away. And again, this is a famous winery that sells wine at $175 a bottle. And they're selling a product that is clearly over the legal limit for volatile acidity in wine. So that blew my mind, and it put into perspective that no matter how highfalutin and high prestige a winery is, I want everyone out there to know, like, yeah, they might be bullshitting you a little bit. And like, their product might actually not be that good or healthy. And when I realized that, it made me take the whole industry a little less seriously, for sure.
Yeah. That's crazy.
Crazy, right?
That is crazy.
Crazy. And then, yeah, I mean, that's something that blew my mind. Mm-hmm. And it was something that I never could have predicted, but it put everything I do in perspective, that we are selling a sound product, providing a good experience. And we can take pride in knowing that, like, yeah, we're far below the legal limit of volatile acidity in our wine. And so, yeah, I got a bunch of other stories with, like, going to New York and, like, getting to meet some incredible winemakers and, like, really ask how they got into wine. But, you know, those have all been the icing on top of a lot of fun I've had.
Yeah, so. Definitely. Well, I mean, I want to thank you for coming out. And, I mean, as far as we're coming down to the nub here.
We are. We got a little nubbies.
It seems more, I mean, I love this cigar. The Night Owl's always been a favorite. And it has, like, this caramel sweetness towards the end. Sometimes you run the risk when you get to the end of a cigar that it gets really bitter.
Getting too much heat.
And then, yeah, like, exactly.
No.
Yeah.
No, but this is really, this is not let up. And I'm getting a little bit more of those fruit notes that you were talking about too, which was cool because I never even conceptualized having fruity notes on a cigar. That's something that, like, I'm like, oh, really? You said it. I'm like, oh, maybe stone fruit or grapefruit. I could see that.
Right.
And I'm getting a little bit more as we're getting down to the end.
Definitely. So. Definitely. Well, and, we have Alex Lewis joining on from Facebook. Saying, just showed up. What are you guys smoking tonight? It is our house blend, the Night Owl, and Devin's from Suveg Winery. And
Alex, nice to meet you.
And we had a Petite Syrah.
We had a Petite Syrah called Sibling Rivalry.
Which is phenomenal.
That we just finished up. And yeah, we're open Thursday through Sunday. Starting September, we'll be open Wednesday through Sunday, which is exciting. Mm-hmm. And yeah, if anyone's local, come by, hang out with me, and drink some good wine.
Definitely. Well, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me on. This has been super fun.
Awesome.
Like, yeah, this has not been hard to do. We should do this again.
For sure. And then for those who are watching, mm-hmm. if you come up to the shop or if you go to the winery, the last Friday of the month, which is next Friday, we are going to be down at Suveg Cellars with cigars. We're going to do an awesome cigar and wine night.
It's always a good time.
Yes. And you can get tickets within the video description here. It'll direct you to our website, and that's where you can pick it up.
Totally.
So thank you again. And you guys take it easy. We'll see you next.